afternoon, and welcome to our session on the future of the U.S. payment system. I'm Cheryl Venable, and I'm with the Retail Payments Office here at the Federal Reserve Bank of Atlanta. I'm here with two of my colleagues. On my left, Julius Wyman, and on my right, Brian Egan. And today we want to walk you through some information about a public consultation paper that we have out for comment right now. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Julius.
Thanks, Cheryl. We're going to discuss the Federal Reserve's payment improvement consultation paper. And so I'm going to go straight to the agenda topic and give you just a real quick snapshot into what we're going to cover today with you folks. So the first item, we'll just briefly lay the foundation, what formed this and put us in this the place that we're currently in to actually discuss a consultation paper with you guys. It's pinned to a strategic planning process we recently completed. We will actually spend the bulk of the time going through the consultation paper itself and then close out with some next steps. So with that, I'll move forward to telling you briefly who we are. The Federal Reserve Banks, it's not that we're all that mysterious, but I want to make sure that this is founded in terms of the context for the public consultation paper. So the thing that we're most known for is monetary policy. The chairman, Ben Bernanke, and soon, for hopes anyway, Janet Yellen will sit in that chair. The basic news stories come from those folks, and that's what folks generally think of when they consider the Federal Reserve. We also supervise financial institutions and help regulate those various bodies in our payment system. But the two boxes, top left and bottom right, are perhaps the lesser known pieces of what we do. The Federal Reserve's banks participate directly in providing financial services to depository institutions and to the government, of course. We are their bank. And we help maintain a stable financial system and help contain systemic risk within it. And this public consultation paper, the work that we're doing, and the things that you all hopefully are going to contribute with us today are what we're going to focus on. And that's what, the framing is for today's conversation. So I want to take you into the strategic planning process. I mentioned in the very outset that we had gone through recent refresh of our strategic plan. And there are some things in it I'm going to focus you on. First of all, right at the very top of the slide, you'll see it talks about having an end-to-end focus strategically. And that may not seem like a big deal, but we are a banker's bank, have been in that space traditionally and focused serving the banking community. But as we look forward into the future and think about what we're going to do with payments and what we might do to improve and advance the payment system, we wanted to make sure that our eyes were on the end-to-end process, so where it starts and where it stops, that the full range of users are satisfied, and that there is improvement across, again, that broader range. So within that, of course, you see three main points here. Safety and security has to underpin the things that we do, and it's an absolute that it will, but we're pointing it out here to make sure that there's no misunderstanding there. And then you get into, I'll call them the flashier things here that are also new to the strategic plan, which is to focus on speeding or improving the speed that payments are delivered, again, for the users and participants in the economic system. And then hand in hand with that goes the improvements in efficiency in the network. Moving forward then, so the work that we've done since we founded ourselves in those basic thoughts or tenets, we want to make sure that we understand, in fact, what the users, that we don't just guess or anticipate based on our own understanding of what sorts of things in the various stakeholders might need, but we actually are coming forward to the industry, to users, individuals, the range of participants and stakeholders, as you see on this slide, from technology solution providers all the way, as I say, down to the end consumer. It's important for us to make sure their viewpoints are understood internally for us, and that we have engaged and exchanged in dialogue. Again, the purpose of this talk today and then the consultation paper itself. The next slide talks about some steps and measures that we've taken since we've begun this. So the Future Payments Research Team was developed shortly after our strategic plan was found and settled to kind of gather together all the thinking and research that had been done to this point. And we organized those. We did several hundreds of different payments research studies, organize those into reports and stories, and that puts us at the point that we're at today, which is to actually come forward seeking input from you, folks that have participated on this call, and again, we want to thank you for doing that, to get feedback and to make sure that the things that we have distilled or synthesized through that research and that initial gathering of information is relevant, and that we have the right priorities and our eyes focused on the right gaps or potential opportunities for improvement. So that kind of puts us in the place for the next stage of our conversation, and I am going to go forward to my colleague Cheryl Venable, and she will talk about those very items.
Thanks, Julius. So as we talked about, the reason why we're here today is to share with you some of the highlights that are in that public consultation paper and how we came to include that information in the paper. Julius just went through a bit of history with regard to the development of our strategic direction, some of the research that we did that helped identify for us what we believe to be are the gaps and opportunities that exist within the current U.S. payment system. And then the consultation paper also includes some of our thinking regarding desired outcomes that we think is important for the U.S. to achieve over the next decade or so. And I'm going to go through some of those items with you now just to give you a flavor of the type of information that is in the consultation paper, and hopefully give you some motivation to go out and read the full paper following this discussion. So on this next slide, on slide 9, we recap the system gaps and opportunities that we identified from the research that we just discussed. I'm not going to go through all of these, but I just want to highlight a couple of them because they're important as we get into the discussion of the desired outcomes. So the first is the continued end-user check writing. So it may not be a surprise that we in the U.S. still, in many cases, are heavily reliant upon the paper check, especially in the business-to-business space. And in many cases, when you write person-to-person or you're writing a check to your local school or a charity. And we have articulated in this particular gap that a real reason why paper writing or check writing still exists is because there's not a really good ubiquitous electronic alternative for the paper check. There's just some things that the paper check is more geared toward and is very useful for the parties that still use those. So as we think about if we truly want to move toward reducing cost in the payment system, moving toward more efficient and effective electronic payments, we have to first come up with an alternative, an electronic alternative that meets the same types of use cases that a check is used for today. And that kind of gets me into the second gap that's listed regarding the challenges in converting businesses to electronics. One of those is the fact that there are still some businesses that don't have the capability to either originate or receive electronic payments, or they're small to medium-sized customers where those electronic alternatives are too costly or too cumbersome to obtain access to. So that that's one particular example of why end-user check writing still occurs. I'm going to highlight just a couple of others before I move into the desired outcome discussion, because it highlights one of our very first desired outcomes, and that's regarding the slowness of the U.S. payment system. We have a number of payment rails within the U.S. I've already talked about check, but we have automated clearinghouse, we have wire payments, cards, and all of those clear and settle on different times. So even our wire payment channel, which is a real-time gross settlement system, to the end user may not clear and settle in real time or instantaneously. It can be days before those transactions are actually posted on one side or the other. So there, as we've conducted our research and have begun learning more about what other geographies are doing around the world, we are learning that a lot of countries are starting to either implement or research implementation of a near real-time or real-time payment system for their retail payments. And that's something that we felt like, as we look at our current systems, doesn't exist in the U.S. today, and something that we ought to be taking a look at. Now, you might say, well, doesn't PayPal do that? Or there's some closed-loop type of solutions that are offered by some of the large banks that might help facilitate these type of payments, and that is true. But it also highlights one of our other gaps, which is the fact that these are closed payment communities. So if I would want to send you a payment through my PayPal account, you also have to have a PayPal account, and therefore would be required to sign up to receive those payments. So it's not ubiquitous in any regard. So let me go ahead and move into the desired outcomes. And as I mentioned, these are articulated in the consultation paper to try to identify where do we think there needs to be, or how, what should be that end state or that desired outcome in the next 10 years in which the U.S. ought to move in that direction, and how might we facilitate those. In the consultation paper, in addition to providing the description of the desired outcome, we also present a series of questions that relate to that desired outcome to get a sense of your thoughts with regard to the information that's provided in the paper. So as it relates to ubiquitous real-time retail payments, this specifically addresses the gaps that I just mentioned, the fact that we really ought to be looking at how can we facilitate access to all in being able to facilitate retail payments and speed the clearing and settlement of those payments, so really to achieve a fuller reach of those types of transactions. The next desired outcome focuses on improved efficiency. As I mentioned, there's still billions of paper transactions that occur today. And that's not problematic in and of itself, but there probably are pieces of that where we want to continue to move toward more electronic straight-through processing to reduce the cost to all parties involved in that transaction. And we believe that we need to continue to focus on that and continue to move toward more electronic origination of payments. We also want to continue to improve upon cross-border payments. So commerce, as you know, is almost borderless. And we need to make sure that we're creating opportunities and facilitating solutions that allow businesses, merchants, and other even consumers to be able to originate payments cross-border in a way that's timely, cost-appropriate, and is transparent with the timing of settlement of those transactions and the actual fees associated with those transactions. And as Julius commented in his opening remarks, the focus of our strategic direction also in these desired outcomes also spends a good bit of time talking about enhancing our safety and security of our payment system. This is very important because electronic payments are built upon trust. And we need to ensure that as we look toward improvements in capabilities and features of payments, that we're also ensuring that we're spending the appropriate amount of time looking at how we can make them more secure. And then finally, a tenet that we put into the paper is one of our desired outcomes is to achieve strategic industry engagement. This is truly important because it is going to take all of us from a financial institute or financial industry perspective to work together to achieve these desired outcomes. If we're working at cross purposes, it's unlikely that we can achieve the objectives that we've outlined in this consultation paper. So we're doing forums like this today to reach out to you to share the types of information that's in the paper. And I'm going to turn it over to Brian, and he's going to talk a bit more about how you can get engaged in providing your feedback.
Thanks, Cheryl. Before I get into some of the tactical things we're doing, let me remind everybody that you have the opportunity to participate today by sending us questions and or comments about what you're hearing today. And I believe the email address to do that is on the screen now. So I would encourage you. In fact, I would tell you we're probably counting on a few questions coming our way so that we can make the conversation a little bit richer and fuller for all of you. So let me talk about some of the tactical things we've done with industry engagement over the past few months and things we're going to be doing over the next few months. As both Cheryl and Julius have referenced, we don't want to make these decisions just within the walls of the Federal Reserve banks. We want to make sure that we're reaching out to all players in the payment system, and that's virtually everybody. And so over the past few months, we've been having some very specific one-on-one conversations with financial institutions, other players in the payment system. And I would characterize those as very open and frank conversations, conversations where we kind of laid out our thinking, what kind of gaps that we've seen. And we've been having challenged about, are those really gaps? And we've challenged the people that we've met with about their thinking about it. And as a result, I think we've come up with a more fuller view of the payment system. And you'll see that as we get into the discussion about the consultation paper. Recognizing we can't meet with everybody one-on-one and have these kind of dialogues, we've also hosted a series of events, and we'll continue to host a series of events, where we get groups of people together in a forum and talk specifically about what's in the consultation paper and try to get some feedback that way. And you'll see that the first town hall meeting that we're going to have around this is going to take place here in Atlanta at the Federal Reserve Bank here in Atlanta on November 12th. And if you see on the bottom of this slide a website address, you can actually register for that event and come down to the Fed in Atlanta, and we can have a conversation about the specifics of the consultation paper and where kind of we're going. The final group that is on the slide here suggests that we're working a lot with industry conferences, and these are efforts really to more educate people about what we're doing and encourage them to participate, and that's in large measure what we're trying to accomplish today, is let you know here's kind of what we're thinking about, here's the direction we're going, and really encourage you to engage with us in thinking about what the best future is for the payment system. So how can you all help us? As both Julius and Cheryl have alluded to, we've created this consultation paper. And it's out on the website, fedpaymentsimprovement.org, where you can download it, take a look at it, read it, and think about it for a bit. And then we'd encourage you to give us your thoughts about what you think the future of the payment system should be. Have we identified the right gaps? Are we looking at the right kind of solutions to bridge those gaps? And you can do that very simply by applying to an online survey that we have, or by creating an email and sending us what your thoughts are. But we need to do that by December 13th. We don't want to overanalyze this. We want to get all the information, but we need to move forward because every day we waste is a day we're not getting the speed, the efficiency, the safety, and security that we really need. So I'd encourage you to take a look at the paper, read it, and if you've got thoughts, please provide those to us. So where does that leave us? We're going to continue to work with people throughout the payments industry, through the town halls, through one-on-one conversations, through meetings like this, trying to encourage you to participate in the process. After we get all of the information in December of 13, we'll bring all the stuff together, and then we'll put together what we think the right vision for the paper is, for the industry is. And we'll lay that out in what we think will be a white paper in the middle half of 2014. And what that white paper will do is allow you to see the vision that we have and maybe lay out some tactical things that we think would be appropriate for the industry to move forward with, and then all of us can work together to make that tactical vision a reality. And so we hope that you'll take the time to read the paper, respond to the consultant paper with either an online survey response or with an email response, and we'll get together back later, the middle part of next year, and talk about what we've heard and where we think we should be going with it. With that, I'll turn it back to Julius and see what kind of questions we've gotten.
So I have the privilege of pitching the questions here, and I'm going to do so to my two colleagues on the right here. Maybe perhaps they didn't trust what answer I might give. So at any rate, we have a couple of pre-submitted questions here, and we certainly encourage you all to send in. We're live here and able to receive questions even at the moment, so please feel free to direct them in. But just to start here, again, with a couple of pre-submitted questions here, and I'm going to pitch this to Cheryl if she'll take it. The question goes, what is the likelihood that the Federal Reserve would mandate or impose a particular outcome or solution? So, Cheryl, Brian?
All right. Well, that's a good question, and I would say that that's a question that we get frequently as we've talked with the various industry stakeholders that Brian shared with you. And, the U.S., unlike other geographies, which I talked about earlier, is very market-driven. And from a Federal Reserve perspective, it's not our intent, nor really within our purview, to mandate anything that would require a real-time, faster payments type of system. That's not the approach that we would take. The idea is that we would, as we're doing now, using our leader convener role in pulling together the industry participants to have a conversation about what are the real issues that we need to be addressing, and then how do we solve those and how do we move forward. And that's the intent, as Brian described, coming back out with another document that expresses The feedback that we've gotten from the consultation paper in all of these dialogues, being able then to identify hopefully a roadmap by which we can achieve those desired outcomes. And again, it's unlikely that we would come out and mandate, because that's not really within our authority to do that, but we definitely want to be working with the industry to move forward in a collaborative and consistent approach so that we can make improvements to achieve that ultimate vision.
Very good. So we actually have stuff rolling in here. Appreciate folks being responsive to that. So I'm going to pitch the question that I just had pop up on screen here. It says, how will mobile payments, or what role will mobile payments play in the Federal Reserve's plan for establishing a ubiquitous payment system, either in P2P or POS transactions? Who wants to take a crack?
Go ahead. I can start. And then Brian or Julius, feel free to add in. You don't get off the hook by just asking the questions. So I think, you know, one of the observations or the opportunities in the consultation paper is a recognition that mobile in general is just revolutionizing the way that we do our business, both from a, you know, consumer perspective and an individual or even a business perspective. So that is definitely a great influence into thinking about how do we need to improve the payment system in order to support or better facilitate or enable payments for, the actual clearing and settlement of the payment for the transaction that's being initiated for the commerce. So for example, you can use your mobile phone and, you know, ads pop up, or it identifies where you are and it helps entice you as a consumer to use a particular product or service or visit a particular store. Well, that's all around the information, and eventually when you go into that store, you perhaps are going to make a purchase, or when you drive by it, it prompts you to make a purchase online. What we want to do is make sure that the underlying clearing and settlement systems that actually facilitate the movement of the funds that support that transaction are done in a very efficient way, a very safe way, and helps, and we're evolutionizing the payment system that's supporting that type of mobile revolution. So that's kind of the impetus behind it. So it's going to play very greatly into where we're headed strategically, and I think it's something that we all need to be paying close attention to.
Yeah, the thing, I think that's all right. The thing I would add is, you know, Julius talked about our role historically has been working with banks in the bank-to-bank space with payments, but we've kind of expanded it with our new strategic plan to look at it from an end-user perspective. And I would suggest that the technology changes, like mobile, are what drove that, because we realized that the bank-to-bank view wasn't good enough with the revolution that was happening with all the technology changes. So I think that's a driving factor to why we're looking at this kind of change.
That's right. I'm going to use one of the questions we have here. I think it's because I've gotten several now, so this one summarizes what a couple of you have sent in, so let me pitch this one forward. It says, do you believe the existing payment channels will evolve to get to real-time payments, or do you believe a new rail has to be developed and migrated to? And is it a combination of these things, or is it too soon to say? So,
do you want to start? I'll start.
You start.
All right. I guess from my perspective that as of today in this conversation, it's probably too soon to say. We have a whole series of questions in the consultation paper that we're asking around how do you achieve near real-time payments? Can you augment the ACH infrastructure, the wire infrastructure, leverage the card networks in a way that would facilitate near real-time or real-time retail payments? Or does it require something that's brand new? And I'll just say, based upon the conversations that we've had across the industry, we have very diverse opinions on this particular question. So I'm anxiously awaiting the types of input we get through this consultation paper, and also looking for, if you think you can increment on the existing rails, kind of how we might do that. What are the things that need to be added to, say, the ACH infrastructure in order to achieve these real-time payments? what type of maybe additional authentication or security that needs to be applied to those. So those are the elements of the question, and I'm going to reserve a particular opinion on that because I think the jury's still out on where that will end up.
So I will say that there's a diverse set of opinions about that, probably even at this table. But I think to the question, I think this is your chance to influence what our thinking is. We really are asking some of those types of questions to get your input, because while we know a lot about the interbank space, we don't know about the whole end-to-end payments system. And so we're really interested in hearing from everybody that we can to get all those diverse points of view so we can kind of build a consensus about what the best approach is for the payment system in general and as a whole.
Yeah, because I would add to that you know, there's so much investment in the current systems embedded in banks and merchants, and to make a move to something new, it could fairly well be, you know, costly. But on the other hand, I've also heard it put in the way of, do you want to continue to Frankenstein your existing systems to try to make them do something they weren't created to do or designed to do? So those are the types of considerations that we're assessing right now.
Okay, I'm going to take a fastball here. And I'm going to try to cover as many of these. We've gotten a bunch, but I'd like to try to get to as many as we can here. So this is not the, at least from my experience, not one we've gotten commonly, but I think it's an interesting question. Because like this, it says, cash and checks clear at par. Most electronic payments, except for the ACH, do not. What's your take on the creation of ubiquitous electronic payments that settle at par, given the Fed's historic role in facilitating other par clearance payment systems? So I'm going to take a shot at starting with this one, if you guys will allow. So, because I think it's a very interesting question. I probably won't get the base if I do. As I say, I think that's an excellent question. And my take on it at this stage is, right now, it's too early for us to say, and it's a very, very detailed, granular question in that respect. And we are just starting our thinking. We're just moving forward here. But what this does for me, and the reason I wanted to pull out the question just personally, is these are the kinds of things that we do need to be grappling with and thinking about. So you can think about a circumstance where the participants that are going to potentially give lift to a new system that you try to move forward, especially if it's not a system that's mandated, and I don't think there's a bias to do that at all, it's important to kind of consider what sort of incentives and motivations do you want to have in place. We have also found the industry trip over this question. So it's a right thing for us to focus on and a right thing for us to wrestle with. And based on the work that I know we've been involved with and our thinking to this point, we will. So I can't tell you that I know exactly what the answer is at this stage. I can just tell you that I think that it's a very good thing to put forward. I'm happy to have it. It's on our radar screens. It will be on mine. I don't want to speak for my colleagues or others here, but I'd be really surprised if we don't push forward in our plan with this sort of thought in mind. So appreciate the question very much, and I'll contribute or ask you guys to add what you would.
The only thing maybe I would add is that we have heard consistently that a lot of the money for any investing, especially in financial institutions, is very focused on just responding to compliance cost. And so the money left to remain to invest is very small. And so in order for us to move forward, something like Julius was describing, there has to be an understanding of how can you create value out of whatever's being created. And we hear that loud and clear, and I agree with Julius. It's something that we definitely need to make sure that we include in our thinking and in our planning. And this is an area that we're going to have to very much collaborate with the industry with regard to a model that is viable going forward.
Brian?
Nope.
Okay, I've got to read this question because it's the first one where I got such a pleasant greeting. It says, good evening. Thank you. It says, as a consumer that uses both paper and some electronic options that are out there right now, what comfort can you provide me and others in a similar position that might be opposed to having options eliminated? And I've paraphrased this just a little bit, and I'll also start with just my own viewpoint on this. So, the comfort is that I think is the right one to start with is that we're talking to you guys. So we're not, we don't have a predisposition to say, this is what we're doing, and we're just having, we're going to publish a consultation paper, we'll do a webcast, and then we'll ignore the rest of the world. This is truly, our efforts here are meant to enlist input, obtain feedback, and make sure that we are weighing and considering it all. I'll also tell you, again, this links to questions we've gotten about mandating one thing or another. It has never been our way to do that, at least not in my experience in payments, and that's more than 25 years. We don't do that. It's not the way we run business. It's not to say that we will eliminate any option at this point. We're trying to consider everything and to have an open viewpoint to everything, but if you just consider historically the way we've conducted ourselves in this space, we collaborate, we listen, pay attention to the folks that give us input and feedback, and then try to do things that there's a consensus view around, and we try to gain a consensus view around it. I'll use the Check 21 legislation as a perfect example. It did not have specific mandates in it. It didn't eliminate checks. It didn't eliminate their usage. What we did was facilitate and, in fact, provide a bridge solution with the image replacement document to allow us to move forward electronically without eliminating anyone's options. So it's a model that I would tell you that probably it would surprise me if it doesn't frame our thinking going forward. It's been successful for us, wildly so in the past, so we would probably take a similar measure moving forward, but trying to strike a balance with actually moving forward. So you do want to make some balance between those two extremes, but that's the general approach I'm going to suggest to you that we would take. So again, to you guys.
I guess the only other thing I heard out of that question is maybe a question about would we ever eliminate the check, which I think some other countries have debated,
attempted,
and then reverted. That's not the intent. If you could look back across the history, I'm not sure we as a U.S. industry have ever eliminated any sort of payment alternative. There are 24, as of 2009, 24 billion checks written a year, and we're just getting ready to republish our triennial study of recounting the number of checks and the other payment types that are originated, and they're still going to be in the billions. And we're all about choice and options, and if we do create an electronic alternative, that's a really good substitute for check, and that's going to happen naturally, and it's not going to happen overnight.
I think the basic philosophy of the Fed is to let markets decide things. And so I think we're going to try to put options out there, describe how they benefit, but ultimately the market will decide what the right approach is, and we'll work with the markets to make sure that that happens.
So I think we have time for one.
One more?
One more question?
Okay.
Or two?
Yep. So I'll read one from a name I recognize. Don't want to do disservice to people just because they know me. So this one says, will the Fed require unanimous support from the largest banks before any possible new framework solution can operate in order to provide a payment address verification service? And I think what you're getting there, and the heart of this question from my perspective is, will the Fed require unanimous support from the largest banks? So I'm going to tell you, and again, this links back to what we've just probably said, is require is an extremely, it's a word we don't use much around here. Again, the whole point of this is to make sure that we are, and the stage that we're at in particular right now, is to make sure we're paying attention to what folks are saying to us. So it's, we're way on this side of mandates and requirements and those sorts of things. We're in the explore, learn, listen, pay attention sort of mode. And so that's where we are right now, again, to when you get to what's happening 2 years from now or 3 years from now and what we may or may not see, things can adjust and amend over time. I don't mean to suggest or foreshadow that that's what will happen. I'm simply telling you that the stage we're at right now is to pay attention, to take feedback, and to listen to folks, and then we'll work pretty diligently on mapping out a framework that makes sense. And again, we've said this, and I don't know if I can overbeat it, but our viewpoint is to collaborate, to work with folks, to educate and inform, and that requires that we also get educated and informed, and then to try to move forward with a consensus approach to things to the extent that we can. And again, balancing that with making sure that in the end there's actual tangible progress that's being made. So, mm-hmm. Others?
That's fair.
I don't know if we're getting at it.
Okay, you can do one more.
I'll see here. I've got a couple. Okay, so this one says, will the new payment system incorporate non-traditional bank services such as prepaid debit cards and direct carrier billing? Good question. I'm going to steer off.
So let me just read that question one more time. Will the new payment system incorporate non-traditional bank services such as prepaid debit cards and direct carrier billing? I think that kind of goes back to the question about would we, those exist today, and would we be suggesting that something that we're doing today be eliminated? And I would say we're not at that stage. So prepaid cards are certainly a real instrument that's used widely today. And I guess that's how I would answer that question.
No, I think that's right.
Agree. Okay. All right. Well, I know that we may not have gotten to everybody's questions, but I would very much encourage you to take a look at the dates that Brian shared in the slides with regard to future forums. And again, also look to create completing the survey or providing your input to the consultation paper as is described with the process in the presentation.
And I might sorry, thanks for the interruption, Cheryl. I might add, we will inventory all the questions. So even though we didn't get a chance to take all the questions and answer them directly today, be assured that I'm staring right at them here. So, and they will be a part. That's one of the things that we wanted to gather here. So I wanted to make that point.
Okay, thank you. So thank you for your time and your participation. And we look forward to receiving your comments.